Is there a script over there?
Yes, tonight's meeting of Conservation Commission is being recorded for RCTV. We're live, yes, Comcast Channel 22, or Verizon Channel 33, and videographer for tonight's meeting is Courtney. And check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. Okay. We don't have any hearings or meetings tonight, but we do have old new business, and
Want to take care of Bowley Coley first?
Oh, okay. That is 281 Main Street, Bowley Coley. Mr. Waters? No?
So it, I don't know, should we go through it? So we were asked one question by the commission for tonight's meeting is, was that intermittent or perennial stream in back of 281 Main Street? And when we issued a notice of intent back in 2011, it was determined that was a perennial stream.
Does it show up blue?
It does.
I didn't, yep.
Does?
But that's the same stream that we said is intermittent behind Cross Street.
But that doesn't show up blue.
Yeah, it does. And this was the thing where Jamie said, we looked at this, that's not a perennial stream.
Right.
And we all said, okay, but we don't have any documentation of that fact.
Well,
USGS is.
And Steve Erickson said it was. Is it perennial stream? Also over at Cross Street.
So what are the implications here?
Well, I think if I could
try
to understand where Jamie was going with that, is the applicant is removing pavers to make up for the impervious surface,
right.
And he was probably going to say that doesn't need to be done if it's an intermittent stream.
Well, I'm the one that brought it up because he didn't know that, was the same stream as Cross Street.
So, so the plan as is, even though it's a perennial stream, is still in compliance if they remove the 60 square feet of pavers.
Right, and it's even simpler than that. The minor project permit, this fits in perfectly. It's more than 50 feet away.
Yeah.
Everything else checks out. The one reason that I wanted to go down there and was on the site visit is I wanted to make sure that the new owner would maintain the stormwater, all the stormwater things down there, and
systems.
He does and will.
Yeah.
So that was the main point, and it is within our jurisdiction, and it does fit within a minor project permit. So. Usually you guys don't get to look at minor project permits, but I did want you to look at this one because we have this site and we have Perfectos there. And
did you take, Chuck took me over next door.
Yeah, we didn't go. We didn't
it
look.
Wasn't on the
agenda.
Right,
agenda.
But I did go over with Chuck.
But before we get there, I know Rick's here and I'm sure I don't know if it, well, you know, the funny thing is that Rick not only did this project over at Bowley Coley, but he did probably phase one-ish plus over at Perfectos too. So
we were on
the
Perfectos project for about 6 years.
Yeah.
We had no longer.
Okay. Let's I guess finish out Bowley Coley.
Yeah, let's get this over with.
So I understand there's a build out of the vestibule to accommodate a business on the second floor, and then there'll be another entrance for the business on the first floor, and so that'll come out onto the impervious pavers, and they're not 100% pervious. But then, are you taking out all of that round area that was used to show those cars?
We take out at least 60 square feet. So the vestibule itself has about a 230. Oh, for the record, my name civil engineers and land planners down in Stonia. So the vestibule itself measures about 230 square feet. All but 30 square feet is on either existing sidewalk roof area or paved area.
Yep.
So there's about 30 square feet that falls into the landscape on either side, about 5-foot strip on either side. Comes to about 30 square feet, so although there was a credit left over from the remediation that was done under ECAS, I told my client, just offer 2-to-1 mitigation, it's a minor modification, and we'll get through this. So that's where the 60 square feet came. It's probably not that entire round area, but at a minimum, it's 60 square feet of it.
Just from an aesthetic point of view, it's gonna look weird.
Well, we don't know how we're gonna do it yet. It's a numbers thing.
Yeah, you know what?
We're gonna take out 60
square
feet.
Probably like take it from around the circle and still leave the circle round, maybe take 2 feet and go all the way around.
Make the circle
like
smaller.
Make the circle smaller.
I think he's gonna get a landscape architect to come in and say, how do I get lawn in here and some shrubs and what do I want to take out? But the square footage was nearly 2-to-1.
And what do you think about the river? Do you think the river like it's the Amazon? I mean, is your view that it's perennial?
I'm trying to remember what we came up with. We came up with perennial stream when we did the, that's why we're under the Rivers Act, yeah.
I mean, it's perennial on the USGS map.
Yeah.
It's a...
We saw water.
There's water in it.
We did.
It's been pretty dry lately.
Yes, it has.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember.
It doesn't look like a,
but
it physically doesn't
do you
look like
remember
a
water?
No.
I am not sure if you use Norse, but it did. No, I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah, there's water.
I can look
yeah.
it up. Our
yeah.
wetlands
doesn't take a lot.
Yeah, that's. I mean, you showed it the way that I think it's always been. It's been interpreted.
How did ECARS permit it? As river.
Yes,
as
river. We did the remediation for it under the
right.
Rivers
right.
Act.
So
right.
let's just leave it
yeah.
as river.
Oh, yeah. I'd say just leave it, but this is fine.
And I understand that they will also be inspecting those storm.
Yes. So the owners, John and John, were not aware. They were told, but it was kind of like a lot of paperwork when they closed.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't aware that they were supposed to do something. I brought the document to them. I went over it with them. They're soliciting to get someone to come out and do an initial inspection
yeah.
because it hasn't been inspected in a bit. We do believe that the way it's written as the 4 times a year and after an inch and all of that is probably too much for what's going on out there. The inspection will show that. And at that time, we'd probably like to come back to the commission and say, hey, this is what we found. Do we really need to do all of this 4 times a year as opposed to once a year or something?
Mm-hmm.
And different things can be at different times. I mean, you can check the head wall once a month. You can check the head wall after a rainstorm, and if you see something, then you know you got to go, you know, follow it. But the separator and all of that may not need to be done as often. But right now, they're good with going with what is.
We have done that in the past. That's a very burdensome. plan to follow 4 times a year, and I think the commission's intent was to understand what's happening out there, and we've reduced several since I've been here down to 2 times a year.
Well, I wonder if that was, although I'm sure you had checked this, but I was wondering if that was maybe conditioned for the first year, and then after the first year, you know, something less burdensome, because 4 times a year sounds pretty excessive.
It could have been what was thought of at the time, but it's not the way it's
gotcha.
So it is written
right.
year, annual, you know, 4 times a year.
We'll
yeah.
take a look at that when it, the
yeah.
time comes.
I think when that was designed, Chuck, I wasn't here, but wasn't that a little bit unique of a design with the instead of the head wall with the catch basin at the edge of the river there, right off the pavement?
The spillway? Well,
spillway, yeah.
Was that a unique design?
I don't think so. We
no?
have
you have several of those?
We have a regular parking lot that comes down. There's 2 catch basins.
Pre-treatment.
They go into
pre-treatment.
They go into the treatment separator.
Well, Jamie was talking about something that the
well, he was
without a head wall.
He was very impressed with the.
Oh, we use a flared-end section as opposed to a head wall.
Yeah, into a basin.
Into a, yeah, we
it's riprap.
We brought it out and riprapped it, so
right.
It opened up more as a level, sort of level spreader area as opposed to head wall high out, yeah.
And then there's an additional mound at the end of the level spreader to do some more.
Detention.
Yeah, just for detention before it hits the river.
Yeah. Right. So I think maybe the board was concerned about that washing out.
They were definitely concerned.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's
clear.
That's maybe the you know, access monitoring.
But no, that's kind of boilerplate to do that monitoring, and that I see that through all the permits, and it forces people to come back in after the fact. But maybe it's good because sometimes we don't get those reports. It's the first thing people forget to do.
Right.
So.
Okay.
So we've got an applicant says he's willing to do them. That's good.
We got one. We got one. I forgot John's last name, but anyways, we got one from ECAR. Yeah, so we had one, and you know, I looked in there, and I don't know what to expect, but it doesn't look outrageous for sediment.
So this is just a minor project?
It's just a minor project, just to make you aware that the ownerships have changed.
We don't have to vote on it.
We don't have to do anything?
Oh, I have no
objections
to it.
Well, minor projects are written that you need to given okay. You can override the fact that I've given out a minor project, so you might as well say that you agree with the decision that this is a minor project.
I'll make a motion that we recommend to go forward the minor project status on the Bowley Coley site at 281 Main Street.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just probably should have brought this up. We were before the planning on Monday. They also approved the minor modification, but they want to see a better, the next generation of an architectural plan. We were pretty basic, the architectural plan.
Yeah.
I will let my client know there's going to be changes on those architectural plans, so we should come back and see.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let's talk about 240 Grove Street, map 38, lot 2, Latondra. And I believe that they came forward with another minor project for the removal of a large pine tree.
Right, so they're looking for a minor plan change, add that additional pine tree to their approved permit.
I guess before the meeting started, there was a question. Did we request them to replace cut trees within our jurisdictional area on a one-to-one basis?
I'm going to have to check the file and find out. This was a March decision, and I didn't have a chance to look into
okay.
it. So if you need to know, I mean, to me, every tree stands on its own, right? So if you want to a replacement tree, it doesn't matter what happened at the last, when we did the order of conditions, because we can't change the order of conditions. And as my recollection,
okay.
the trees that we took out were by Moses, Bob Moses.
Yes.
He said some were damaged.
Correct.
And there were some scrub ones over on the by the property line. So I don't know what we decided with
that. I can't remember either.
Yeah.
This
is a substantial tree, and that's why I think they wanted it to stay. So you would be completely within your right to ask for a replacement for this tree.
I would suggest that. I don't. What are the other members?
Yeah, I agree. I think
feel
that,
in lieu in. In keeping with the
where it's in the woods, it's not, or right on the edge of the woods. It's not like it's in someone's front yard, and it's it's contiguous to the forest. So I would say we should have a replacement tree.
Okay.
So this tree they're removing, according to the plan, it's a 32-inch pine. It's inside the forested limits of the
sort of right on the
yard.
Edge.
Oh, it is? Oh, according to the plan, it doesn't, that's not the indication, but you went to site visits and that it was on the edge, okay.
Yeah.
And they're proposing to plant a variety of bushes and shrubs.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, and removing a number of trees.
So all the trees are down except that one.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, no, I concur, I'd like to see another tree in there. Based on the picture, it's pretty substantial. And there was no indication that it was sick. It just said it was a potential hazard if it fell, which is any tree. Any tree's a hazard if it, all the trees in my yard are hazards if they fall in the wrong direction. I mean, so, yeah.
It's the kind of tree that was, when it was, before they cut all the other trees down, it probably didn't stand out as a, something you'd be worried about. But then when you see it all by itself and they limbed it all the way up to the branches.
Yeah.
It's a very tall tree. It's got a split, you know, a double trunk.
Yeah.
And it looked completely healthy. But normally in a forest, when you've got other trees around it to buffer it from the wind, you wouldn't worry too much. You wouldn't, you know, it wouldn't be an issue.
If you look at this planting plan, they're calling for a white pine of 6 feet. They're calling for a 36-inch high blueberry. They're calling for 24-inch eikenberry, 24-inch, I mean, pretty substantial planting list there, including a 6-foot tree already. That's nine, that's eight, seven shrubs and one tree. Kind of like this, this plan's incorrect because when we were out there, Harry, right, we were on the crest of the hill. So if you look at the topography, that's like 212, and this tree's marked down at 208.
Right.
That's like way, you know, pretty far down that hill, and that was up on the top of the hill.
You think?
On the crest.
Yeah, I didn't really notice.
Yeah, it was
where
it
was.
It was fairly high.
Is the dark line the hay bales?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's supposed to be.
I didn't remember it being that far.
It wasn't that far past. It was a lot closer to the hay bales than that, for sure. But, you know, it does have the double trunk there, which, you know, every arborist who comes in here says that, you know, the rain gets in there, it rots, it's got more potential.
So he's got, I didn't notice all the new plantings on this. So we got the three pines
it's
going
substantial.
In right in front of it.
One, two, three, four, five. That's considering that, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it looks like there were seven trees were removed within the 100 feet.
Sounds about
one,
right.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. But now the new one is 7.
The new one would be 7. Yeah.
Right.
I mean,
so
I
he's
I'm
got.
Not, I'm
there's
not, I'm
eight.
Not arguing. If we want to replace some tree, that's fine. I mean, that's kind of a lot of plantings in a small yard. But if he needs to replace that tree, I'm not
I'm
arguing
okay with
that.
That. I just
I'm fine with that.
I'm okay with it. I mean, the truth is, they took down 7 trees this big, and they're planting some blueberry bushes.
Yeah,
it's not comparable, but.
No, but it provides habitat.
I mean, it's okay. It's
okay.
We've replaced
shrubs for trees on this board several times in the past.
Yeah. Yeah. And
the eastern pine that are being planted are outside the 100 feet. So they're along the left property, the south property boundary. It's a kind of a confusing plan, but
there's
they're the dots with the circles in them.
There's three right here.
There's one,
IV.
Two, three, four, five, six,
those
seven,
I saw
eight.
Pine.
FP.
Yeah, they're all in the buffer.
EP.
Inkberry. HB.
Pine?
Existing. That's the 22.
The
22
oh.
that they're taking out. I think.
Yeah, I think you're right. There's so much on this little page.
There's a lot to look at in this small space. I'd like to see the pine tree replaced.
All those plantings are inside the buffer.
Yeah, most of them. Yeah, they are.
Except for the trees. So the trees I have on, I could see on the plan are right here on the plan, if you're having trouble finding it.
Yeah, I see them over there, yeah.
So having one tree replaced within the 100 feet.
That's fine, alright.
I think that's reasonable, I think that's appropriate.
That's consistent with what we've done in the past.
Alright, do I hear a motion?
So moved. Replacing the pine tree with a native tree.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Two Maple Street, map 16, lot 111 Hannon. There was a denial and we've asked, well, we've recommended to the applicant to hire a wetlands consultant to determine where the actual wetland line is. Have we heard anything further on this project?
Yeah, he wanted some clarification on our decision and was wondering why the town GIS map wasn't considered accurate and his stamp plan by his land surveyor. And I just told him that the commission didn't feel like it was in the right spot and like to have a wetland scientist out there. And also to get a variance, which may be needed, he needs to file a notice of intent. So he knows all that, and I haven't heard from him since they sent that email.
Okay.
Which one is that?
That was Maple Street, Minot Street.
It's
and
the
you go down to the end, and it's a small house, but that's where there was a, one of the conservation areas is located.
Where the septic was, where the giant footy was dug already?
Yeah.
Yes,
oh,
yes.
Okay.
MWRA 62 Oak Street bypass.
One second. This needs to be signed. It was just a standard denial form.
Okay, while we're signing that, Chuck and I did meet with MWRA out at 62 Oak Street to listen to the gentleman from Albany's Construction talk about when they have to cut the pipe underneath Oak Street. They want to take the stream and pump it across Oak Street and then put it into a plastic sheeting to dissipate the energy. And it's kind of on a, up on a hill, sort of away from the other downstream side of the stream. And the sheeting is in actually a pretty flat area. And then at the edge, and there was a quite a bit of discussion, there was, what's the name of the woman from MWRA?
Mary White.
Mary White was there. Actually, quite a few people were there. And Chuck and she talked about actually putting even another row of sediment control, like hay bales, like in a horseshoe. And there's discussion back and forth. We had talked about putting the hay bales on the plastic, but if you do that, you punch holes in the plastic and the water goes down in. So it's right basically at the edge. And then there's quite a bit of flow over this flat area, all vegetated, you know, herbaceous growth. And it goes, I'd say about 20 feet until it hits the downside of that stream. So, and they sent plans to Chuck, and I think he sent those out to everybody.
I did.
Is it flowing right now?
It is flowing right now. Oh, and by the way, on the uphill side of that stream, they put a big pail and they put a pump in it, and they showed a detail of that pump or a couple details of the pump systems. And then, are they putting a rock, are they putting some kind of rock around that pail? I didn't really quite understand that.
They are, what I heard was they're worried about the cleanup after the fact. So they want to put the stone in a 5-gallon bucket with holes in it and submerge that. And that will pump it out. But they were saying the pump needs to have some sort of pretreatment for the waters because it can't and it can't pump sediment.
Okay, alright, that's what they're doing.
So it's gonna operate sort of like a sump pump would, where as the water goes into the bucket from the stream, it'll pump it out across the street.
Right, is that right?
No.
No?
5 gallon bucket, well, what you said is the 5 gallon bucket is gonna have holes in it and it's gonna sit in the stream. Is that what you're thinking? It's not gonna fill in from the top and then pump up.
Right. It's gonna come
right.
in from
it's
the
gonna,
side.
It's gonna come
it's
in.
Gonna infiltrate
so
the
it's
bucket.
Gonna be just put in a low spot. I mean, that's usually what happens. What they're exactly going to do is probably more about what's happening that day they go out there. But they're gonna put it in a low spot and they're gonna pump it. The runoff was so low that they're not coming back for 6 weeks anyways. There's likely to be nothing going on.
Yeah, six weeks. And it'll take about 3 days, three days to a week to remove that pipe and put the new one in. So that's the length of that pipe, that pumping. And that's about all I know about it.
Right. Yeah, so they're going to block the culvert. It's going to pond up. They'll have the bucket with the holes in it in there with stone in it with the pump in it, and the pump will run continuously across the street and discharge on the side of a hill with the plastic and erosion. And then the water will flush through the vegetation and back into the stream.
So is this, like, what are they asking us to approve? An NOI or a...
So in the order of conditions, if they need to do any pumping like
oh,
this,
so they already
on we
order
need
conditions
to approve,
for the road
the, yes, they have
okay.
an order of conditions for this project. We need to approve, review this plan, and this one actually says approve it, but we've taken out that language now. We just want to review the plans, so we don't want to hold anyone up.
Okay. I mean, it sounds reasonable.
No, yeah, it did. It was the best we could do, and Mary White was also involved, and we had Caliaco up on Oak Street and West Street when we couldn't stop that sediment from getting into the storm drains and going all the way down, you know, into the next mm-hmm. town. So we used flock logs at that point, which worked out really well, and they came back and cleaned everything up. So this is the same group, the MWRA, making sure they're not going to have any problems from the start this time. So I'm confident. Should be fine.
Sounds good.
That's just a discussion, correct?
Yep.
Okay, next item is a certificate of compliance for 270-05582C Street, Abreu. Original he lost his copies, so he needs a new copy signed. Everything's approved so that it can be recorded at the Registry of Deeds. And we talked about this the last meeting, briefly. Yes, we did.
There's been a few of
it
these.
It happens a lot.
Yeah, there's been a few of these.
Well, people forget about it, and they go to transfer their key, and the lawyer picks up on it, and they have to...
This
yeah,
is a little
lawyers.
Bit crazy because there's notes in the file that says that the original order of condition wasn't recorded.
Really?
Yeah.
Great.
Well, it must have been if they're coming back, right?
That's what I was wondering, and I asked them that the same thing, but they did have their closing already, and they made their agreement, so he has to stick to it. But I asked the same question. I said, how was this found? And, you know, I could only think of that old saying, you know, he must have just said it. You know, he must have just mentioned it, because if it's not on the deed, how else would they know?
He told on himself.
Yeah. Couldn't keep quiet. Maybe that was it. Okay, here we go. So this is just a signature to have a original for the...
So if that original order of conditions was never recorded, isn't it expired? What are we signing to?
The certificate of compliance.
Yeah, we're signing a certificate of.
What?
Well, theoretically, you should take the order of conditions down and get that recorded and then record this as well.
I mean, we have. Right.
I mean, what are you gonna find in the chain of title? You're gonna find a certificate of compliance to nothing.
You probably have a copy of the order of conditions.
But we're not responsible for the chain of, for the title recording, so.
Are there any ongoing conditions in that order of conditions?
They're there on that page. You can read them.
Yeah, that's in the package. It's.
I mean, if they only want another copy, I don't have a problem with that.
I don't either, but I just. Somebody down.
Who's responsible for filing the order of conditions?
I guess it'll be the next person who buys the house will.
Their attorney.
The lawyer's gonna see this and then say, where's the order of conditions, and then.
I think applicant's responsible for.
They'll be back here.
We'll see, yeah.
So if they don't, how do you enforce it when they don't comply?
Any.
Okay, well.
Austin Prep School, wetland replication area.
No good deed goes unpunished.
What?
So I sent Dr. Hickey an email and he sent me back that the hay bales have partially been removed and they'll come back and remove the rest of them. And he also said that some additional plants were ordered, but they haven't arrived yet. And he just wanted me to check in to the order of conditions and find out if they had to do that monitoring report a second year, which is pretty standard.
I thought it was 3 years was our standard, like once
two
a year for 3 years.
2 years on replication, 3 years on invasive removal is standard.
Okay.
But I don't know standard in this town, but standard kind of around, when you're doing those things.
So we're not into the second year?
No.
I would expect two, because you want to know it's planted and if it's correct.
See if it
survived
a season.
Survivability.
Well, and especially because they're doing additional planting that hasn't been completed yet.
Mm-hmm.
We're not really into that clock cycle yet.
Right. I mean,
so.
I don't know if they need Mary Trudeau to come back out and do that three-page, four-page report. Maybe something a little simpler.
Sure.
A plan where they planted the species, the additional species, and I mean, we can go out and take a look if they're viable.
Mm-hmm.
Second year.
Right.
I could. Yeah. I'll. That's what you guys agreed to. That you'll just check next year.
Well, we have to check anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Right. For their certificate of compliance, right?
So you're willing to waive the second report?
No, I don't. I'm saying the clock hasn't begun for the 2 years if they're still talking about planting.
No, it has.
Oh, it has, because we already issued.
You don't hit the reset button every time you plant a new plant because one died off. I mean, it's
so the planting is a result
package.
Of that previous report,
right.
Reporting on the
yeah.
status
and then we
of
got
viability.
The new one.
And some
so
of
this. So I think we need another year of growth to see if what they've done.
Yeah, actually, if that's in the order conditions, a second report, why wouldn't we ask for that?
Well, I think what you're talking about then is a third report to make sure that the trees survived a second year, the new plantings, a year later.
As far as I know, we've received one report.
No.
So it's
in
the
second. So we still only want one more?
Yes, that's what all we've asked. Yeah.
You know, what format and what...
Chuck,
we haven't
Chuck
dictated
can give them the direction.
Exactly.
Listen, we just want to.
What we're looking.
Don't go crazy. Give us a report that they're growing. We're going to check it on the certificate of compliance.
I mean, the report, I think in the order of conditions, it does say what the report has to cover is the status of growth, right? Whether the plants that have been planted as a result of the order of conditions are viable and thriving. And any, I mean, I thought the recommendations in the last letter was. Appropriate and I appreciated that professional input. So
okay.
So it looks like that's on its way. The next question might be to release some part of the bond with holding back only the part that pertains to some
plantings.
Cost of planting.
I think that's reasonable.
Yep.
Okay.
Have they made a request for that?
I'm just letting you know that that could.
That
could happen.
Next.
Yeah, they haven't asked.
Okay.
Certificate of compliance for 270-0643, 1261 Main Street, Ahern. You guys went up there on Sunday.
I don't think Harry was there the first time, so I was there both times. The tire and the fence in the back was cleaned up and looked like it was raked over a little bit. The issue for, we figured out, or somebody figured out, because when they were there, that issue in the front was for his trash cans. The homeowner did that. He dug out a flat area to put his trash
that's
cans
what
there.
Chuck had said.
Oh, all right.
And then through the discharge, just on the side of the hill there, that was not cleaned up. And we didn't know of that. Is that footing staying or going, or we just okay with that? It's only a little corner of the footing. I don't know if we made a request
the base
for that
of the stairs?
To be moved or not. Yeah, that's actually in the 35, but
I'm fine with leaving it. As is, it might just cause more disturbance, I think, removing it.
Well, the only issue
is
that...
And then once it's removed, what goes there?
The only issue is that the original plan showed it on the other side of the deck, which would have made so much more sense for everybody for exiting and entering the deck on that side of the house. So now you're going to walk down the stairs and walk around that wall and up the mountain to get to the driveway?
Well, do you think it was a setback issue?
No.
The stairs getting too close to the property line on that side? That's
no,
why.
Well, then you still could have went directly on that side off the back of the house.
Yeah.
I see
that as a construction issue that would have been cleared up if there was like a resident paint, you know, or some sort of construction manager really paying attention to the approved site plan and understood the consequence of.
Well, I mean, it's just
moving
like
those stairs.
I mean, it's.
I know.
It's probably inches either way. So I mean.
I know it's
regrettable,
it's
not,
but
it's not a big deal.
But I don't.
And it's going to get low traffic. No one's going to use it. There's no place to go.
We also went out on Tuesday evening, and Chuck did ask there was still a piece of metal piping out
there. Oh, back there.
Yeah, we asked that be removed, and I believe that was removed.
He agreed. It's not removed yet.
Oh, all right.
But we'll.
I'll
make him bring it to town hall. Did I make
him talk to him about the trash cans?
No, you know what? That's just something that I to me, it was just more of a mystery. I mean, you gotta have a house that you can live in, and he's gonna put their trash cans on an angle, and they might fall into the street. I thought that was.
Well,
within
it's not,
the
it's
right
not
of any homeowner.
The flat spot for the trash cans. It's that he threw the fill on the hill that's going to wash into the resource area. But he could have took that fill and put it in the back of his couple wheelbarrows in the back of his truck or something. But
I think in the back of my head.
Again, it's not a huge deal.
Yeah, the homeowner is. I think we were told by a neighbor that the homeowner maybe his wife might be expecting right now. And so when that all ends, I think I'm getting a application for a fence in that yard, more of a fence, keep the dog and the kids, you know, in a contained area. So that would be a great opportunity to talk to him about that.
And come to, and that area of 28 doesn't have a sidewalk that somebody can put their trash cans out on.
No,
they don't.
You know, so that makes a lot of sense to me that they would dig that out.
And it's. Incredibly scary as a passenger to
only when I'm driving.
Is
that pull out onto that road?
It's a hazardous exit.
That's scary. It really is, because the guardrail. It's like you can't inside lane, or you can't see.
No, it's blind.
No, in northbound, it's now a Pinewood Derby trying to get into the right lane.
Oh, it's.
See, the car that flipped over the other day.
I didn't see it because I couldn't.
I guess that was at the other end of this property.
Yeah, because Karen next door was talking. They all went out and took pictures of that.
Oh, wow.
Okay. So we're not issuing tonight, right?
That's up to you.
I don't mind issuing.
How do the other members feel?
I'm fine with issuing a certificate of compliance.
All right. Do I hear a motion?
I move we issue a certificate of compliance for 270-0643, 261 Main Street, Ahern.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. I wanna thank everyone who,
Yeah.
You didn't help me.
I, you know what happened?
What?
I went Saturday.
It was Saturday.
No, it wasn't. I parked on Haven and walked down. There was nobody there.
What time'd you go?
Where's the Friends of
Like
Family?
5 o'clock?
On Haven Street, it was at Birch Meadow.
Oh, wasn't it at Haven Street last
no.
year?
No, you're thinking about
Haven
the other
Street.
Thing.
Haven Street is the fall town fair day.
That's where I thought
Friends
I,
and Family Day is over by
going.
The high school.
No,
over by the
no,
high school.
The rain
the
came
I
and
went to the wrong spot. I'm sorry.
The rain came and I got to.
Was there plenty of parking? Like unusually light?
Well, yeah. I parked on my I parked on 309 Haven because usually I can't get down there. I walked about 30 feet and says, where is everybody?
I did a really bad job advertising on this.
I'm sorry.
And
then I'm glad, I was going to go Sunday, but my daughter had a baby christening, so I didn't go, so I'm glad I would have been. I
wouldn't
have walked down
been there
again.
On Sunday
you
either.
You can go back this Saturday, too. It's not going to be on Haven Street.
You know, Al, you missed a photo op.
I was there for hours.
Pictures.
Would you walk in and walk out?
I walked in there because at I don't know, something like 12 or 1 o'clock. And my daughter was supposed to perform. She was going to play guitar and sing. And
oh,
so she was all excited. And the
Where's
bands,
the caption? No names?
Yeah, it's in there above.
It's up above.
The band before her, they got all backed up, which always happens. So they were behind. So then, you know, I'm looking at the radar on my phone. There's this giant red blob coming at us. I'm like, we're doomed. Because I figured I'd get her set up with her guitar and then go over and work the booth for a while. And then the skies opened up. It's like, oh, I got two guitars and an amp sitting over there. Daughter in a wheelchair. I got to go.
right. Yeah.
So that was that.
Actually, we got some vegetation. Natural vegetation and
yeah.
wetland vegetation, invasives. And a lot of people came by and talked about the invasives in the yard.
Hmm.
So it kind of opened the dialogue, which was great. Gentlemen came by with two maple leaves, and we were able to confirm that they were not Norway maples, and that we had an example of Norway maple and could show him the difference. So that was good. And Anika brought the folks that put in for the drawing for the
buttonbush?
No, it was a sweet pepper bush, Clethra alnifolia, and Time at Material Cabin. So does anybody want to draw? We're going to draw tonight. Is everybody listening?
I don't think I deserve to.
That's right, you don't.
I was going to say, Al's an unbiased party because he was not present. So
he's present in his mind.
So
you should throw him.
What?
What?
I was just going to make it.
Throw them all up.
Throw
them
on the floor. Whenever ones are upside down, you take those and throw it again. And
okay, this is
finally
for
come up with the last one.
Chris, 978-476-0671.
Okay, so that's the sweet pepper bush. Okay. Congratulations, Chris. Didn't give your last name.
Anonymous.
But I think everyone's going to be phoning him or her right now.
Yeah. And the other one?
I'm sure the phone lines will be light.
Have Harry.
Okay.
Have Harry.
So,
no, have Harry.
Okay. Without the phone number this time.
Oh, that's too funny. It's Chris.
Chris is a double winner.
Were you allowed to fill up more than one, evidently?
Yes.
Yep.
Wow.
Okay.
What a lucky person.
Okay. Congratulations,
well,
Chris.
It's 40 of them.
That was random.
Yeah.
That was not.
It's interesting.
So I also brought tonight, I just to ask the other members to please sign. This is a thank you card to Garden in the Woods, who donated a nice expensive bush to our cause.
I suggest you print your name.
What are you trying to say?
They're not going
to
know who we are.
So. No, they're not. But I was, you know, I was going to write a little.
I'd be like, who's this
something
guy?
More than thanks. but oh, I thought it was a worthwhile day. It's too bad attendance wasn't
wasn't
that good.
There
was the weather.
Yep.
So. Oh, and we also included brochures from the high school Envirothon team from this year. So there were a series of, there were a bunch of high school seniors who are in the Enviro Club at the high school. And they were, with the help of a teacher, they participated in the Envirothon, which was a competition in that had to do with an environmental topic. And this year's environmental topic, very timely, was invasives. So they came up with, they wandered Birch Meadow and came up with their own invasives brochure of how to identify, here's what it is. And they picked, I think, the top five that they encountered.
Yeah,
that's
really good.
And so we just got permission and photocopied the brochure and left it out to the public to take. And you know, and we invited the high schoolers to come and also stand at the booth with us. You know, I don't think anybody bit, but the teacher came over and talked with us for a while. So I thought it was worthwhile.
Madam Chair, I have to return a phone call. I'll be right back.
Can't believe this.
Okay. We have a Al, what's going on with your, I know you have to recuse yourself, but what's going on with lot three? Okay.
We don't have a quorum anyway.
We do,
yeah,
we just
right.
don't have a, oh,
no,
right.
we don't.
You're right.
Thank you, Harry. You're right.
Can I see your sticker? Thanks. Okay, so we'll pass on that.
Yep. Continue certificate of compliance for 270-0582, 244 rear of Ash Street, Northeast Cutlery. This was, they didn't have anything last week.
I didn't know anything about this. Is this, are they waiting for us to approve a certificate of compliance?
No, they haven't finished their work.
Oh, okay.
At least they hadn't the last meeting.
Should we hold off until Chuck comes back?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, what's our options?
Well, we can talk about officer election, chair and vice chair for the next year. But I prefer to have more folks here. We're missing.
I would too. Our next meeting date is
13th.
July 13th?
Yeah. Yes. It's in 3 weeks.
So, the best of my knowledge, two
None
members are going to be missing. To the best of my knowledge, though, Madam Chair, two members are going to be missing at that meeting.
We don't have two members. Is that what you mean?
Two members will no longer be here.
But we'll
at
be
the
adding
July
another
team.
We'll be adding another member.
Okay.
So we're down
so
one.
So why don't we share the
yes,
while we have a chance?
Yes. When was the first election? It wasn't last night. A couple of weeks ago, somebody, Dave.
I don't remember. Sorry. I don't know if you remember the last election.
Where you got elected?
Well, the name of a potential.
Yes, David Paulette. Is that
Dave
his?
Pinette.
Dave Pinette put in his papers, and he was appointed by the Board of Selectmen a couple of weeks ago. He just retired on Friday, and he was a information technology teacher at Wilmington High School. Before that, he was a contractor of some sort. I did call him today to invite him to the meeting, but he had a previous engagement. Hopefully he'll be here, but did ask me when the next meeting was. Jamie Moan and Anika Scanlon put in their papers, and they were interviewed last night?
Correct. We were interviewed last night as by the Selectmen's Volunteer Advisory Subcommittee.
Now, were you there for the vote?
I was there for the Volunteer Advisory Subcommittee, and I was there. Chuck and I both sat in the audience during the vote.
And you were voted 4-1. Four in favor?
Funny, I didn't notice.
Four in favor, one against.
Mm-hmm.
And Jamie had put in his paper for an associate membership, not a full membership. And he was 2 in favor and 3 against. So he is not back on the commission.
As of June 30th.
Right.
It's interesting.
So that is that. So, and Amy Shikitani is in the process of moving to another town. She's found an apartment for her and her family, and so she will not be on a commission. So gained one, lost two, so we're 6 members.
So what is the timeline for electing our officers? Do we have one?
I'm not sure.
According to the town bylaws, I believe it needs to be done by June 30th. That it has to be done by June 30th every year.
I'm sure we could vote to amend that to July 30th. And wait till we have 6 full members here.
We have, you know, we have not always stringently adhered to that
we
in the past.
We didn't do it the last time.
You know, we've addressed it. I think one of the times I was voted chair, it was in July or August or even September. It was sort of as, because that was when the membership was finally at maximum attendance for a meeting. Okay, so we're kind of falling into that same trap.
Yeah.
That we've got, you know, we've got some shifting membership, and I don't know who's going to be at the July meeting. I will be at the July meeting.
Should we vote to extend, or should we just ignore it until we can vote?
Are you going to be at the July meeting?
13th?
Yes.
That's the plan, yes.
You're going to be there?
Yeah,
I'm
sure.
Going to be there.
As of today.
I don't know if Mike will be here. I don't know if David will be here. So. We could do a vote just to extend it to the next meeting.
Well, we don't know.
Or we could make a motion for chair and vice chair and continue that. But
you can't extend it.
We can't extend it.
No.
It has to be voted on tonight.
This is the last night. Yep.
Okay.
Why are we waiting?
Well, there are only 4 of us.
Amy no longer lives in town, and Jamie.
I just explained that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So. But there's Mike.
Right. And David.
I think, so my sense of what's happening here is you two stepped in halfway through a full year just to try to, because
Brian
left, right?
Brian resigned.
Right.
When did we vote?
The last time, do you remember which month?
I think he left in January or.
No. When did we make the vote?
The last time, it has to be made in June, by the end of June.
So he left. When did he leave?
He thought January.
I don't
look at me.
Okay. Yes, that seems about right.
Because he didn't go to the conference. He didn't.
So.
And he missed a few meetings. Because I was filling in, and it was about around then.
Well, I feel as though, unless Harry feels differently, that the status quo is fine with me.
Yeah.
So let's make a motion to keep Rebecca as chair and Anika as vice chair. You second it and we'll vote.
I second it.
All those in favor? All those opposed?
No abstentions, Julie's abstaining.
Oh, and this is Julie's last meeting.
Yeah, we're losing.
Thank you, Jules.
A lot.
You're welcome.
We are losing.
Thank you very much.
Julie and Jamie.
I did bring that up before the volunteer advisory subcommittee, because I believe, I'm not sure which of the selectmen who were present during that meeting was our liaison. Because they seemed unsure, but then they thought they knew, but but I did bring up that we were losing a recording secretary, and that it was gonna add quite a bit of strain, and it's definitely gonna turn the minutes into something different between now and whatever happens next. So, you know, I let them know that.
Just do the best we can.
We're gonna do the best we can.
Taken in any community
yeah.
ever.
You've done a wonderful job. Thank you, Julie.
Yes, you have.
We're not gonna be able to live up to that in your absence, but we're gonna have to make do.
So our making do is like, I just wanna, you're saying we're doing a great job. How we're gonna do is, I'm gonna be taking the minutes, and then someone from the commission, it doesn't have to be the same person all the time, will back me up by taking the minutes also.
Can I ask a question? Can.
So that could be you, Al, right? So
what a lot of commissions do is just record.
I was gonna say, we could go
why
back.
Why don't we just record?
We could go back and review what happened that week. And maybe we could, you know, assign somebody on a rotating basis. You know, give it somebody a template.
Do you know if that's okay or not?
Do I know what?
If reviewing the recording is okay.
I think so. I've gone back to it when I didn't quite hear something or understand something.
Well, let me ask this. What are the requirements that the minutes contain? Because it's nice to have and there's required to have, right? So we have to record the results of all the votes, right?
Correct.
We have to record who presented and who spoke, right?
Correct.
And some basic commentary about what was said, what ideas were presented, what debate might have occurred.
And how it was voted, right, yes.
And what the vote was.
And the attendees, and.
So, I get that, but if we just record the meeting start to finish with an audio recorder and save that in the archives, and if someone needs to go back to June 22nd, 2006, then there's a thumb drive or tape
that says
that.
Oh, so you're saying
the
recording takes the place of the minutes?
No.
Yeah.
I don't think you can do that.
No.
They do it in a lot of communities.
Here, you have to have a copy in the mall in the possession of the town clerk.
I think one of these days, Alice probably going to go there.
Yeah.
I
mean, it's the whole thing's being digitally recorded.
I think it sounds like Town Hall wants to have a paper copy.
That's my sense. Is they're pretty serious about this?
Also, if you do have the video, you have to go through the video and find.
See, I think that's a pain in the neck.
That thing, you have to read through the minutes.
I think that's easier than.
But if it's a 3-hour meeting, it's another 3 hours you're going to spend watching that video.
Well, only an aggrieved party at some point in time is going to do that. How often, Chuck, in the last 6 years has we had to give the minutes to somebody who's aggrieved, somebody who's appealing, or. I mean, that's the only time it comes up, right? If somebody
I'm not following you. So,
appeals.
So we record it.
Twice. Chuck says twice in 6 years.
Let me propose this. You write down, I think part of it is, so you type as you go, right?
Mm-hmm.
I almost feel like I'm a big form
but
of.
It's a mess, and then I pull it all together, and then if I'm missing something, I'm.
You do go back and take a look at that.
I'll take a look.
We write down the highlights as we go. Not the highlights, but you capture the information that you need to capture to meet the requirements of minutes. We know that it's also video recorded. You meet the standard that the town wants us to meet in terms of quality of minutes. write it down, you do it, I do it, one week, Al does it another week. At the end of the meeting, go over it, make sure we all agree.
That's a great, that's a lot of time to, this meeting tonight, ish, last week was short, but there's a lot of meetings. We're sitting until 10, 11 o'clock at night. Think I wanna go over, you know, 3 hours of minutes at 11 o'clock at night?
Just the highlights, like if somebody, does anybody?
I'm not saying everybody stays.
It's just 30 minutes to talk about one thing, are you kidding me?
I'm not saying everybody stays, I'm saying you close the meeting and then just compare notes, you get that vote, you get that vote, you get that vote.
I don't think that's so onerous.
Maybe we try a couple different things.
Alright.
They understand your.
What is the?
About not having anyone?
Yeah, the town manager explained that it's a, staff availability in town hall seems to be, challenging to attend the meetings, and that,
Didn't Kim used to do them, Chuck?
Kim Saunders?
Yeah.
Yeah, she had Kim doing them,
She's not available to do them anymore?
She does several, Caitlin does several,
What?
They already do several meetings.
You mean they do like, planning board?
Some other, yeah.
Yeah.
Selectmen and.
I think one of the main problems, I don't know if it's a problem, but one of the main issues is that the conservation clerk, who doesn't wanna do the minutes. So I don't know if that's the natural person that would do it, but she's done it before and she's okay with not taking on that role again. It was too much time and whatnot, so she's already put in.
But she'd be compensated for that?
Yeah, everyone gets paid for it. It's not free.
How can she say no? Who's her direct boss? Who's Ann's boss? Is it you or is it Jean?
No, it's definitely not me. I know that she won't do it. I don't know if someone feels like they could force her to do it. I don't think that's the way things go these days.
I don't think you could force somebody to do above
and
beyond.
Well, if it's in the job
description. Well, it probably, well, I haven't checked her job description. But I know that we've talked about it a lot, looking for someone, and she's just said she's done it before and she doesn't want to do it now, not to me, but to other people who, you know, like Julie Messier, and then she said it to Jean, so.
I don't.
Jean thought there was something
to
be done.
I mean, you have your own hours, correct? And then this is additional. I don't think you can make somebody do additional hours.
So the.
I mean, you can, because you have minions.
So it sounds like you're starting to understand the pickle we're in here.
Yeah, but
we have to reproduce these minutes.
In City Hall, is there not a clerical person or an employee that wants overtime, that wants a little additional money in their paycheck, that could take on the task?
Gotta be careful, huh?
What was, I think it was said there was a challenging situation and with the staff in Town Hall right now. So.
This is Conservation Commission?
Oh, do you know where CPPC is?
I don't think there's any other meetings, but there's a meeting room right there.
Oh, this is the counter, Bruce. When the light goes on, there's a red loose leaf folder over there.
All right, thank you.
So yeah, my there would be if the powers that be are requiring a paper copy of this, such as we've been doing, we need to find somebody to take Julie's place. If
and
it's
the
funds are available, but a person's not available, is what you're telling me.
I don't know if the
funds
are
available.
Oh, you
don't know if the funds are available.
So we've been available for.
Well, so we should ask if there are funds available.
There was a plan to address the situation earlier with a letter, and I think what we've that letter hasn't been written yet, and I just think that from what I heard, we're going to own this minutes for a while, maybe the end of the year, calendar year.
Okay, so we're going to have to deal with it.
Well, if the, let's ask the question, if the funding's there.
Makes a ton of sense to.
If the funding's there, then we could put out a email request for anybody in City Hall's looking to pick up some overtime.
We have to go through Public Services, and we have to go through Julie and Jean, and just put our request into them. And it would be great just to understand, or for this commission to say, look, we understand there's a situation right now where we're losing a secretary and there's no one available right now, but is there any expectation to have one by the end of the year? Just kind of understand where you're at. That question definitely hasn't been asked. I think everyone agrees that it's hard for anyone to pay attention and take minutes at the same time.
And review them at the end of a meeting and edit them. And
I think we have a responsibility as the commission to ask for what we need in order to run an effective meeting. I think that's what you're saying.
I'm saying it doesn't hurt to ask. I mean, if the answer is no, the answer is no, but let's ask the question.
I have no problem asking and being told no, and then we're on record as saying we've asked.
Right.
Here's how we're doing. We're asking again. We've asked, you know, have to be on record as asking.
I mean,
okay.
I think if it so there isn't any funding, I think there's people that have been in this before us in this audience, concerned citizens. I bet if we made a public notice for a volunteer position to take minutes at the conservation meeting, there'd be a good possibility of finding somebody. You know, Amy wanted to be involved. She didn't really know specifically a lot about wetlands, but that would have been some way to help the community.
Or even an associate member.
Meetings, take the minutes.
Associate member.
So it's kind of a two-tiered question. First of all, are there funds?
We wanted to be involved.
Are there funds available? And secondly, is it required to be filled with town hall staff, or can it go?
It doesn't need to be filled with staff necessarily.
I mean, that's how it's been.
Right,
that's
because
how
there have been
I'm
people
just saying.
Available, but.
It goes to through town hall and the people that work for the town first.
Right, they have
and
first
right of refusal.
Right.
That's fine.
And then it possibly could go out to everyone else in town. I don't know. I didn't get clear direction on that part of it. But what I did get clear direction on is we're not going to have someone available coming up to our first meeting in July. It hasn't been talked about. There's a lot of pressure right now on people for doing extra jobs. We lost a few people. And I just think that this is something that we're going to have to do. Now, I've done it for my Lakes, Ponds, and Streams Committee up in Boxford, and I did it for the Conservation Commission when I filled in for Ross. But there was always someone else you could ask. What seemed to be the tricky part, which this commission didn't adopt or hasn't been doing, is how to review them in between meetings without violating the open meeting law. And that's the part that, you know, I don't think that we understand, and you know, this commission hasn't done before. I certainly can send out the rough draft. You guys can make notes on that, you know, using track changes, and then send it to me individually, not to everybody. Don't
hit
reply all.
And that's how we've been doing it.
And then we can combine those at the end of, you know, when they're approved, you know, or at least bring a master version to the meeting. Usually people don't disagree about the same issue. And that's definitely not going to happen all the time. That's my opinion. But it may be better than you think.
And until I think we get a permit that is so discussed, debated, and onerous that you know, and
well, that's
you
when
know,
it goes out, and you make a condition, and I don't have it correctly. It was something you did.
Right.
You said it, so you make sure it's written
mm-hmm.
correctly in the minutes. That's your responsibility for you. Harry has his own responsibility for what he says, and that's what we're all looking for. I don't know if Harry should change the minutes to reflect what he thinks you said.
Well,
that's
going to
be confusing.
I would do that if I think that she said something and didn't get captured. And You didn't capture it and she doesn't remember it, but I remember it, I'm gonna say it.
So you're gonna make this really confusing?
I just think we have a responsibility to just do our best.
But we've got the video replay.
I think that part would come at the meeting when we're all sitting here and talking about it.
Right, right. I think we're gonna find a way to, we've got enough information and resources to cover it.
Let's say, well, I guess you could do that, but make sure you just send it back to me. You know, don't send it back to everyone or Anika, because she's gonna say, no, you're not right, and that, there you go, there's the violation. Or you are right, I had it wrong, that's the violation.
You can check it with the video.
So.
Yeah.
And I've gone back and looked at the video, videos.
We'll get it, it's not gonna be impossible.
But I want us to be on record, I want, Chuck, I'd like you to go ask for funding for somebody to take minutes.
Do you think it should go through Chuck, or do you think it should go through chair or?
Vice chair.
I don't know, actually, honestly, I don't know the best way to do it, I just, I think a formal request is.
May not be a bad idea for us to go and speak with, I mean, who would we speak with?
I assume.
You'd speak to Jean Gelios.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we should get a meeting with her.
Okay. And just bring up the concerns that our members have discussed tonight.
And to ask if there's funding and.
If there's funding, we wanna know if it's possible to send it out city hall wide, what's the procedure for letting people know there's a couple extra hours available if they're looking for it.
And
if there's not funding, ask if it's okay to put it in the public domain for a volunteer position. And I hate to throw that out there, because the first thing she's gonna say is yes.
Why does it have to be volunteer? Why couldn't the person on the outside?
Well, because if she says no funding.
Well, we don't know that yet.
Yeah, I mean, I think we gotta get at that answer question.
Let's do one thing at a time.
I mean, the town budget is effective July 1st.
Yeah.
So July 1st, there's a budget which says.
So the question is, if there's funding, does it have to be, it probably has to go to somebody currently.
I almost feel like it's not our job. It's like, you guys provide us with somebody to take the minutes.
If we don't do it, we're gonna sit here and take a minute.
No, I understand. I understand, but.
That's right, because if the budget is passed July 1st,
Well, it's already passed.
It's already passed.
Presumably.
It's already passed. It takes effect July 1st.
Oh, well. I guess I'll have to find some money someplace, huh?
Well,
maybe
anyway.
In there.
I guess I'll come out of your paycheck.
It may be in there. We just don't know.
I think they assume that there would be a minutes secretary for each board.
Okay. Let's ask the question. Let's get a meeting and then ask the question.
So who are you going to ask?
Jean Delios.
She's the assistant town manager.
Skipped over Mariano Drive. Is there anything on Ash Street, 244R, Chuck?
Nope.
I didn't think so. Any report?
There's no report.
Nope, emergency permits, and then we have a Pearl Street water and sewer bill.
That's right.
For $13.14.
We have budget for that. Things are very bleak these days, budget-wise.
All right, everybody.
All right, everybody.
Ante up.
I got five.
$3.
You know, one of the things that the selectmen ask or should have asked is to remind you guys that it's not one meeting every other week. There's more to do than just come show up and, you know, give verdicts on what comes to the meeting. You have to put more into it. Well, we knew there was site visit, but it's exactly. And that's not, this commission is not doing any more than any other commission in this town or any other town is doing. And most towns actually put their own minutes together. So I think we would understand the terminology. We could, you know, drill it down to just the bare basic needs of what has to be said, forgetting about all the rest.
I don't look at it.
We're definitely going to have an opportunity to do it, so we'll see. But I think what we shoot for is the beginning of the year, maybe someone would be available.
I don't think it's so much, from my vantage point, I don't think it's so much of a, you know, I can't put in another hour on top of the whatever we're putting in. For me, it's sort of like it's a risk thing. It's getting it right.
Well, that's right. Well, now we have seven people paying attention to getting it right, and then you have a meeting to discuss it all at once, I think it becomes more important, because like I said, you're gonna be concerned mostly with what you said and you know, the tone that you wanted to put. So I think it'll work.
Can we approve the bill?
Make a motion to pay the water.
Street bill for
$13.14. Do I hear a second? All those in favor?
Thank you.
I know that we got some comments in red line from Mike Flynn on the minutes.
You don't have a quorum because I wasn't there.
Alright.
Sorry.
So we can vote on them next week and the next meeting.
So when it comes to minutes, that is an administrative act that the commission does. So you don't have to be present to approve minutes.
Oh.
Okay, did you read them?
No, because I wasn't there.
And it's the same with signing orders of conditions. So it's administrative part of your, of this committee.
Gotcha.
So is that anywhere else at?
Well,
can we?
You didn't read them, we can't, you know, we can't.
Well, I read them, did you?
I'm all set on the minutes, so.
I'm completely satisfied with the minutes from last meeting.
Do I have a motion?
Make a motion to approve the minutes from the last meeting.
I'll second.
I mean, I can vote in favor of them.
Yeah?
Okay, all those in favor? Thank you. Okay, tree policy, is that, well, Harry, Al, and Nikki, you've been very active on this, so.
Is that in, we didn't have that in the package, we sent it out before.
No, no, I got it.
Week before.
You got it, okay.
Yeah.
I don't know that I have them in front of me for some reason.
Let's see if I can.
But, you got an extra?
Nope, but.
We'll just share.
We could share.
Alright.
Yeah, we could do that.
I have a question on, well, I have a comment on applicability. I guess it's the second sentence. It does not apply to trees that fall of natural causes, weather, rot, or death. What about die? And are you talking about they have to fall or can they be stand? I have a dead tree and it's standing up. And there are some, there are dead trees that we do see standing up. Do you want to mean to include that?
Well, what we did here was we met as a group and we just talked in fairly general terms about what do we want the scope and all of that. And what I tried to do was just give us something to respond to. So this isn't necessarily, like this is our recommendation, but like we didn't talk about whether the tree was dead or alive. So if you think it adds, makes it better to allow people to cut dead trees, I guess. I assumed if you had a dead tree that was standing in your yard, you would still need approval if it met those conditions. If you wanted to cut down a tree this big within the 35 foot and it's dead, you would still need approval. And if you have a one or two trees less than 16 inches in circumference, which Jamie asked to all say, which also equals 5-inch diameter at rest height, that if it was 25 to 100 feet or 26 to 100 feet, you could cut that down. But if you have a
but we've been allowing people to take down dead trees, and we've seen a lot of them that are standing up, not the ones that have just fallen over and been there for a long time, and we haven't asked them to replace.
Right, we haven't.
So
you know, it comes down to, I think most of our tree permits have, when they've come before us, we've been dealing mainly with the trees they want to do something about. You know, it's not that we review their whole property and say, well, that one's dead, what are you going to do with that? Or this,
you know, because they're the ones paying for the work that's happening. So I think what Harry was probably trying to put make a part of this was that thought of that Chuck had told us that in our as our general practice so far, we don't usually ask them to replace dead trees.
Okay. So
we can exclude dead trees. What I said here was the usual practice will be for the commission to require one-to-one replacement for trees removed. However, the commission may at sole discretion apply a different standard when conditions warrant. We can say explicitly we will not require dead trees to be replaced with live trees.
I think that would be.
You guys agree
it was
with that?
Not, it didn't kind of make sense from what we've been used doing as a practice.
Yeah.
Am I looking at the wrong notes?
That's it.
The same thing you got, right?
That's it. Yeah.
Right under the last sentence of the summary is where it says, however, the commission may at its sole discretion apply a different standard. Right above that it says, removed with, I'm sorry, I'm all over the place, I'm tired. The usual practice will be for the commission to require one-to-one replacement.
Maybe
how about for live living trees?
But you've got it as applicability. You've gone down to applicability and you said okay.
Yeah. So what I said is, in summary, if you're going to cut down a tree, you have to replace it 1-to-1. And then I said here, if a tree has already fallen, that's out of scope. You don't have to worry about that.
And my contention is that even if it's dead and it's standing up, it shouldn't be part
that's
of
fine.
It. Okay.
So
does
it otherwise flow okay?
So
I mean, do you feel like it's contradictory?
Yeah, from what we've as a practice from what we've been
not the dead tree thing in general, the way this is laid out.
Yeah. I had to kind of get
I mean,
wrap
I'm
my
a banker. I got to make it more complicated.
I had to wrap my head around. I had to wrap my head around. I thought the minor project, I have to confess that I thought that was $150 one. And the RDA was $100. And I thought the minor project was $150 and the other one was $50, but I got that wrong. So I did agree. I see where you're going with the 1 to 2 trees. Both less than that, in that 25 feet, because that's that vegetation area.
Yeah.
And then when you get out of that, if they're small, there's no approval required.
Yeah,
right.
That makes sense to me. 1 or 2 trees, at least one greater than 16 inches, RDA, and then at 26 to 100, minor, and then the big ones.
It should be 25 to 100. I'm sorry, at the top of the chart, it should probably be, you know, within 25 feet, and then from 25 to 100 feet. Otherwise, there's that 1 foot that somebody will say, my tree is in that 1 foot no-touch zone.
That's fine.
Well, I think that's right.
Can we do DVH instead of circumference? Or is that going to...
What do you think is more...
Well, I did... The reason
you,
I did that...
You gave
I talked to Jamie about that, and we thought maybe we should just do both. Because the reason I did 16-inch circumference is if I walk into my backyard and I want to know whether this rule applies to my tree, I'm not going to drill a hole through it and push a ruler in and say, oh, the diameter is 5 inches. I'm going to wrap a tape measure around it and see how big it is.
Well, that's not how you figure out DBH, but...
But DBH, but pi times diameter, it's going to give you the same outcome.
Yeah, but you just use a ruler on the tree... At breast height, diameter at breast height. So you just need to figure it out.
Okay.
So
I mean, I was trying to make it simpler on the.
I know that that's more of a.
We can do both.
Tree.
Tree guy thing.
Tree landscape.
Terminology.
But I kind of liked it. Why don't we do both? But I did like the circumference because.
I thought the circumference was definitely easier.
It's easier for a homeowner, and what are we getting? Mostly homeowners with this. This issue in the
county. Yeah, I think if we
put DBH comes before us, they'll have both.
Yeah, I think if we have DBH on with some explanation for
yeah, okay. All right. So that's fine. I thought that might
that might create some discussion. So where is that? Is it just here?
Where did you put that?
Is this CBH?
Oh, it's a note for tree working group. Mass DEP defines a tree as 5 inches diameter breast height, which is the 4.5 feet. Since you're advocating, I use pi diameter to get the 16 inches. So we could do both.
Okay.
And then on the applicability of trees within, this is just a kind of a thing of mine. In order to provide habitat for birds such as woodpeckers and other cavity nesting species, because it's just not birds, woodpeckers.
Okay, wait, I can't take notes this fast. We're doomed for minutes. But
it's squirrels, it's raccoons, it's bats. Bats, big deal in those things. When they're not in their hibernacula. You like that word?
I'm going to have to write that down and look it up.
I know you did.
I had to pay people to mist net bats. They'd go out with these really, really high nets and catch them and count them in the middle of the night, all night long.
Why?
Because when you put in up wind farms, big deal. It kills them a couple ways.
Chuck, can I just ask, has our typical policy, Chuck, has our typical practice so far been that we do not require replacement of dead trees or trees fallen as a result of acts of God?
Acts
storm,
of God,
storm
definitely.
Damage.
You know, if it's
storm damage,
no question about it, a dead tree, no replacement.
Yeah, okay.
What if it's this big around and it's 10 feet from a river? Would we still be?
And how close to the house? Was it within 25 feet of the house?
Well,
10 feet around.
We didn't say that. 10 feet around.
I think this is based on health and safety. So everything should be proximity to the house. So if it's far enough away that if it did fall, or if it's leaning downhill from the house, this doesn't apply. So there needs to be some sort of disclaimer in here to, you know, help me out when I go out there, or things aren't always, you know, it'll be able to be changed, or because you can have a dead tree leaning downhill 25 feet from the house, just, you know, it's just not gonna fall the other way.
So you want to keep the dead tree?
Yeah, so if it's dead, why do we care if they cut it down?
Well, the dead wood does provide, you know, the dead wood does provide habitats and food source for insects and
so
habitat
you just go out
for
into the woods
birds
and
okay,
and
cut down all the dead trees.
So I don't think that's our intent. I think if you
I actually kind of have a problem with the dead tree thing, is that dead rotting wood attracts termites, and you really don't want it close
to the house.
And I've had people come in, and I had these dead logs, and they're quite a ways away, and I used them to edge my beds, you know, between the lawn and
right.
the bed. And the guy who, you know, does the external says, get those out of there. So, and I thought it was quite a ways away, and I'm thinking, wow. So
you know,
I'm a little worried about that.
You know, the bug guys I've talked to about termites have said there's three types of houses. The ones that haven't had termites yet, the ones that have termites now, or the ones that had termites in the past. You know, so there's, you know,
yeah.
they're coming for the house because they know there's wood there.
Yes, but you have to have if it's treated wood or it's new wood, you're not going to have the termites if you've got that dead stuff.
But how does that,
if you've got
the
dead stuff right?
Policy though, you lost me.
He was thinking of keeping the dead trees, if they're just even if they're close to the house, if they're leaning away, because they're not going
to
be.
No, they have to be far enough away so it's not a problem. I mean, it has to be safe first, but if it's dead, it's only not a it's only not a replacement tree, it doesn't mean that you can take it down.
I think we're cutting it too fine. You know, we can edit this, I mean, we can look at it in a year. I think for first pass, since we've had no policy, let's have something that is really simple to understand. It gives us some clarity. And if you want to cut a tree down, dead or alive, and it's in the 25-foot, you need to come to us.
So let's nail that down. What, are we agreed on that point? That
well,
if
yeah,
there's a tree within the 25-foot, they need to come to us. And what type of, and what type, how do they come to us? Is it a minor project? Is it an RDA?
No, minor.
I mean, at what point would it be an RDA?
So if you think about this, so let me walk through this grid and like imagine what it is. Right. So the first one or two trees, both less than 5 inches. So that's 2 10-foot tall oak trees this big around, right?
The saplings, yep.
They're
saplings.
Yep. If it's within 25 feet, dead or alive. It's a minor part. You just need to go talk to Chuck and get a minor permit. It's not the end of the world. But you're stomping around in the woods. You're close to the protected area. If it's more than 25 feet away, you're fine. Just cut it down. If you've got at least one that's bigger than 5 inches, up to this big around, within 25 feet, you need an RDA. Maybe that one's too strict. And then three or more, all greater than 5 inches, you need an RDA.
Well, we could lump this, but you wanted to isolate it for this provision, for the 25 to 100.
Yeah, because if you, you could have a third size dimension. You could say anything less than 5 inches, 5 to 12, 12 plus. But you know, then you—it's so open to interpretation.
Yeah, but you're not asking. Yeah, don't. It
gets too convoluted.
It's too complicated. And what we've been asking for is not—we're not doing them in increments as the replacement. You see what I'm saying? You're asking, we've been asking for, what is it, about this much.
So that's in here.
Yeah.
So if you're going to replace a tree, we want it to be between 4 and 10 feet tall with a trunk circumference of 6 inches, which is at the root ball. So, you know, this big around at the root ball and between 4 and 10 feet. So if you're getting one of those, you know, skinny maple tree, the tall skinny maple tree, 10 feet tall, this big around, fine. Or you might have a 4 foot tall pine tree that's this big around, and that's fine too.
Why don't we, I'm not familiar enough with trees to know if a 4 to 10 foot tree base would be.
Yeah, Chuck, do you know
the diameter at the bottom? Is that something
I went
you
online
lifted?
And looked at Northeast, the one out in Amherst, Anika.
Oh, New England.
And Mickey Marcus.
Yeah, New England Environmental.
Yeah, and their biggest tree, I don't think was 10. What were you asking for?
Between 4 and 10 feet.
4 feet, yeah, but 10 feet. And I don't know.
So just how about just at least four feet tall.
I'm overconfident. And then we can like not even put in the diameter at the base
because that may be another
challenging hoop to.
It may make a difference between the species too.
Right. Right.
The natural species.
No, I know that.
Species.
But we want
species,
at least a 4 foot
how
tall
they dig
tree.
Them up.
Yeah,
that
that's
good. All varies.
Like, yeah.
Okay.
I can only talk about gallon buckets. You know, it's a
two-gallon
bucket or a three-gallon bucket.
How about, 4 feet tall.
Just a 4 foot tall and just leave it at that. A native. I have to, just as a comment, we have asked.
Can I also, before you do that, though, I will go back online and take a look at, they come in different sizes, and I'll take a look at the top size and see what the height is.
I'll send it out to everybody.
I think if we set minimum requirements, that gives the applicant the flexibility to put the right native in to suit the conditions of the location they're trying to put it.
Yeah, I was trying to make it so that, I mean, these are just homeowners who want to replace a tree.
Yeah, give them some flexibility.
Right, right.
You know.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Dig a hole, here's where you go find the directions on how to plant a good tree.
Yeah.
Here's the list of trees, get something 4 feet tall.
Yep.
There's a great list of trees, and shrubs that I saw, some for dry conditions, some for wet conditions.
Yeah, I want to address that a little bit, because especially in that, one of the issues before us tonight, was it Cross Street?
The rear, 244 rear Cross Street?
Bird Street, the pine tree.
The 34-inch pine tree that was going to be removed. I think, you know, in a number of situations when people have a forested area behind them and they ask for permission to have trees removed, and then they say, I don't think I want more trees. You know, and that's when, in a number of situations lately, we've agreed to a variety of shrubs.
I really like
large shrubs. And I think...
I like the shrubs.
I think it adds a lot of benefit to a diverse landscape. You know, it's not just a lawn, goes straight to a forest.
Mm-hmm.
It's provides a transition zone.
It's actually more natural, right?
It's
if you have a meadow,
right,
or a backyard,
right,
and a forest in between, you have
right. So
undergrowth.
So I think.
That
you know,
they also have the heights, and actually the highest tree and the highest the biggest shrub were actually very comparable in price.
Right.
Which so it's like, oh,
right,
great, because then you don't have the homeowner really whining about
the choices.
But, yeah.
Right. They have
more options
that are suitable.
And you know, if you've got a really large, fast growing tree really close to the house, you don't want to put another one in there.
No.
Really. Yeah.
You know, and I don't know if we want to say in this tree policy something like at least if the applicant chooses to replace a tree with a large shrub, a large growing shrub, that has to be at least at a 1-to-1 or 2-to-1, or what are we going to... You know, what are we going to say about replacing
shrubs? I think 1-to-1 is fine, and then give them a criteria of shrubs, too, native species shrubs that we want, just like we're giving them a list of native trees to choose from.
Yep.
And for dry areas and wet areas.
Okay, so we can add to this that native shrubs, should we say large growing shrubs, or should we, because...
No, it did.
We want some non-growing shrubs.
Charlie Brown Christmas tree shrubs.
No, in terms of native shrubs, I mean, there are certain rhododendrons that stay dwarf size, you know, and I don't know. I just bring that up. That
I think
shrub with the list.
I think the list.
Shrub with the list.
I'll try to send that list of tree shrubs, dry, wet areas. Guys, and that'll give you, and they were all really good native species. And I think that Northeast Nurseries, is that what it's called? And then, there were other nurseries that came up. It wasn't just them, it was Weston's. It was.
The recommended native plant materials list came from, that's a link to the Commonwealth's list.
Mm.
So
I'll go on and take a look at
so
it.
I like that because it if they update it, this link will update. And
right.
We don't have to mess around with, their list is out of date.
I'm not so worried about
that. Not
that
it's
going to
go out of date.
I kind of like the idea of trying to create our own list so we can, instead of saying what Anika wants to say, we can just put it on the list. All the shrubs that we list on there will all be species we all
recommend, that's what this
which
is.
Are some of the larger species.
That's what this is for trees, so I don't know if they have a shrub list as well. I'm guessing they don't.
Yeah, but we could also say in there that we will entertain and consider other native shrub options not listed.
There's something else on this, trees with, should be cut no lower than 8 feet above ground.
Let's solve the shrub and tree thing.
Alright, so I'm gonna put in here, replacement trees must be native species selected from the recommended native plant materials list, or be acceptable shrubberies.
Replacement trees.
Shrubs.
Or shrubs.
Shrubs, not shrubbery.
It's an ode to Monty Python.
Yes, it is.
The lodge, and now for something completely different, the lodge.
But we're not gonna add government shrubs, cause they're all gonna fall under the.
And that's a native species.
We didn't define it as shrubs at the beginning.
It has to be, would have to be put back. I think saying something in the policy in terms of, at the commission's discretion, shrubs can potentially replace trees at a one-to-one replacement.
So replacement, come back to this. Replacement trees must be native species selected from the recommended native plant species list, or be shrub or shrubs.
Does that recommended, so I don't know that list, does that include shrubs or is it only trees?
I'll take a look at it.
I can't remember, you know what, I might have it on my phone.
I mean, we can, I think we are trying to say though that we're looking for native replacements. And I don't think we need to necessarily supply. I mean, we could say, do we need to supply the list, or can we just say to them, touch base with our administrator, or check our town webpage?
We're gonna put this policy on the website with a link to whatever list you guys decide.
Right, so I'm trying to make it so that people don't have to go to Chuck.
Is there, Chuck, do you have a recommended list, or is this?
Yeah, we have a recommended list. I actually emailed it to you guys about a month and a half ago.
Right.
So we have that.
Yeah.
And it was, I think it was basically the same as this.
I don't know what that is, but
It's the Commonwealth's list.
I've noticed there are some on my list, Abrevadi's not on there. You know, I don't know if that matters. You're gonna find different things in different lists.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's true.
Well, what's great about my list is it gives you where to get these trees, you know.
Oh, do you remember where?
Well, Mahoney's and, you know, places like that. I don't mention Home Depot, but.
Okay, so I have yours here. It has shrubs. It has shrubs.
Yeah.
And herbaceous and ferns.
Okay.
And where to go. So
yeah,
we can just use
that. List.
Okay.
Recommended. Well, that's what I used. We're done, I'm sorry. That's what I used. I just did it so long ago, I forgot. So that's already in there.
Okay, is there anything else on the policy we're missing? Or what do you want
to? Yeah, I had some comments, but get to me later.
Do we want to use the word river here in the summary, in the wetlands? Does that put us in the 200-foot range that we'd have to address?
I figured we have the latitude
wetland
to
or river.
Create a rule that applied
differently to riverfront?
I thought I'd just leave it the same, so we don't have to talk about, is it a
river?
Riverfront area
is
wetland.
200.
No, I know that.
It's 100 foot the inner riparian zone, the outer riparian.
I know. But since this is all within 100 feet.
So what is the tree policy in the outer riparian zone of the river?
Over 100 feet from a river, you're in the clear.
So then why are we mentioning river? Why don't we just say wetland?
Because then someone would say, well, what about a river in a 200 foot?
We don't have a tree policy.
So it's
each individual applicant.
Then you're back to having people come with, I got
well,
a tree 150 feet from the average on a river.
Yeah, we don't get that a lot though.
Well, we have quite a few perennial streams, which just includes riverfront area.
Yeah, theoretically, you're talking about requiring approval to cut down a tree in front of the ECARS building. And that's what I'm trying to avoid.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, me too. too, that's why I was just thinking of deleting it.
So I just lost this. Can I use somebody's sheet for something? And somehow I erased it. Where I was concerned about this was it where it said, let's see.
Cut no lower than 8 feet?
Right here, so it's in the summary, the usual practice will be that the commission require 1-to-1 replacement for trees removed within 100 feet of a wetland or river. And I think the river should be, it should be more like 100 feet of a wetland, 200 feet of a river. And is that what you guys were just talking about?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I just want to be consistent with the Wetlands Protection Act.
Right, right.
So.
Right. I mean, the riverfront has its own performance standards and it has its own.
Yeah, but if, okay, I thought that the first, the 100-foot riparian zone, if it's natural, is important for wildlife habitat. But if it were grass and if it's in an area where there's a, well, I guess that doesn't apply to Brenning. Cities, it's not as given as much protection.
Right.
If it's
like the Charles River in Cambridge.
Right. And so
25 feet or
so it
even.
Would be this kind of the same thing with Boldy Coley because it's all it's kind of developed.
Mm-hmm.
That so that inner riparian zone really doesn't function to provide a whole lot of habitat because it's paved. It's already disturbed. Is that where you're going, Chuck, with the riparian zone, with the river?
That's good, but I was just wanted to be consistent and let people know because, if, say, there a big lot comes available, this is going to allow them to clear cut the second 100 feet.
I think something could be put in there to say, you know, previously disturbed.
Is this going to be every time reviewed? This is not giving anyone permission to do any work, so it all needs to be reviewed.
That's what if they're within the 200 feet, they have to come before us.
Right.
So, at that point in time, we can address that.
Well, but I think what Chuck's saying is what I wrote there says, if you're between 100 and 200 feet, you're in the clear.
And you can cut anything
you
want.
Cut anything you want.
Right.
It says, there's just 1-to-1 replacement within
about,
the first 100 feet. So the second 100 feet.
How about if we clarify in this last box, we say greater than 100 feet from a wetland, no application, but 100 to 200 feet in the Rivers Act requires review by the commission.
It's not the outer riparian zone, right?
Yeah, it is 100 to 200.
No, I understand where it is. I'm saying,
I know you do.
You know very well where it is. I'm saying, it's does that have to provide wildlife habitat? What was I can't remember
what the performance standards are for
the
outer riparian zone. Well, I have it here. I think I would make a motion that we write some of these down as things to look into and continue to the next meeting because
right.
I don't think we're going to get to the bottom of all of it. I think it's a lot of good
okay.
points to
but
discuss
think,
and carry
yeah.
on.
Okay.
So I had another comment that
let me have that just to write that down.
We can look into that. So you're saying the wetlands somewhere on there it says the Wetlands Protection Act or the town bylaw. It should be and.
Oh.
Chuck's turned into quite a little lawyer over there.
Building residents, property jurisdiction of the wetland. Well, within.
No, you're always coming from. You always are under both.
Yeah.
Under.
Never under only one.
Okay.
Because then you'd have to come back and get the other.
There have been a very
small. Not
going to
fight you over the or and the and.
There was. you're right.
Yeah.
But there have been cases where we've done a vote. On the Wetlands Act, the State Wetlands Protection Act, and then we've done a separate vote on a permit according to the bylaws. And under one, it held up, and on under a second, it failed. And that would be, I think 14 Strawberry Hill Lane at one point.
That's okay.
So
we
have, but you're right.
I don't understand why that happened, but
that's fine.
That's not how.
You're good. So Chuck,
because of the work that was proposed.
And I would only say that I'd like to look through that myself. And I thought it was just very, the way you guys wrote it was very loose.
Okay.
And you wrote things like may be required,
right,
and it's possible we've done that. So things like that was like hitting me. So you
must
really,
and will.
Yeah, you want to
okay.
get some, just have that rigid. And I said, already said that I'd like to see, no matter what it says, it's up to the discretion of the commission to make changes either for less or more trees.
Yeah.
So it's up to you guys to do that.
Under bid specs, the bid spec documents, I thought it always had to say shall.
Right. Yeah.
Right. Shall. Not will. Shall.
Right. That's contract language. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Then Chuck and I had talked about this cut no lower than 8 feet, and we're trying to protect wildlife habitat, but you were saying, your landscape architects were saying that you don't have to have 8 feet, you need to have at least 3 feet.
You have to at least 3 feet, but 8 feet is good too. So you have, you could, you
some
know,
variety.
In some cases you could say, hey, look, it is close to the house, but I want to leave something.
Yeah, yeah.
3 foot would work.
That's fine with me.
And sometimes 3 feet is more manageable to whoever is working with that.
You don't want to be running through the woods in the dark.
But I do agree with Harry. It's not easy to write it all at once. And if we get something that we all agree to, it would be nice to see how it works. And then make some changes.
It was fun looking up things.
So what did we, I'm sorry, I was taking notes and you guys talked about the 8 foot. Do you want to change that to 3 foot?
This is giving me horrible thoughts about minutes.
Yeah.
So this is just a policy.
Yeah.
We're just making
yeah,
policy.
Yeah, and Chuck, you're right. That language, got the disclaimers in there that we reserve the right to basically do whatever we want, case by case. It's just a guideline.
You mentioned something about, I'm sorry, I'm just trying to catch everything that everybody said so far. The habitat for birds such as woodpeckers, da 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 da.
Another.
Do you want me to shorten that to say to provide habitat, period?
Right.
Well,
they
don't have to know what habitat,
yep.
Doesn't matter.
Provide
yep.
habitat, okay. All right.
Provide, yes, habitat. Wildlife habitat.
Wildlife habitat.
Period.
Okay.
So.
And who's gonna check into the river?
I'll do that.
I guess we'll all have some thoughts.
Oh, we'll all do it, but I'll do it.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what happens if,
why?
Let's think about this practically. So Johnson Woods.
Right.
And the thing in Woburn. They're within, that's the Abajona River. We know that for a fact, right? So.
Right.
We wouldn't allow them to cut. Let's think about it this practically. So you want to come in with a big development. And there's, you know, you've got the whole area is wooded out to the 200 feet from the mean average
mm-hmm.
bank, mean high water for the bank. You would be looking for them. So they wanted to put something in like this, really close. So you would be looking for them to put in replacements for all that was cut down. Where would you stick it?
Well,
in 200 feet.
All we're saying is,
first,
I'm just trying to get my head around.
No,
if I were to develop.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
That's why I said may need to replant a replacement.
Um.
Let me think about that. I, we don't need to talk, oh, it's something I need to think about.
But keep in mind, they're also gonna be doing an RDA and an NOI anyway.
NOI, yeah.
And so this is asking for at least an RDA. So you're already.
And I think the language at the end covers us for an odd scenario like that, where we say, you know, obviously, we don't want you to replant a hundred fifty trees.
I mean, it says, however, the commission may at its sole discretion apply a different standard when conditions warrant.
Yeah.
Yeah, the, I mean, this is a great document for the landowner that wants to.
And that's what it was really written.
But let me throw out to you a situation where, a, empty lot, a forested empty lot, sandwiched between a commercial, well, a res, two residential lots.
Mm-hmm.
Was, clear cut to the river of all the trees. And there were 24 plus mature trees, on this lot that were cleared out, and it was just the attention, it got some attention because there were no longer trees there, and so it became an enforcement order before conservation. And it then it became a court case, to contest the violation of the cutting of trees. And that turned one half of a river, only along that bank in town into a canal. And there's no other canal space in Reading except on that half of the river, between the property boundaries of this particular property. You know, it's, you know, I've seen some wild stuff happen, and a lot of arguments be made, and.
You know, maybe it's not, maybe I'm overthinking it. What you could do is put landscaped areas, natural landscaped areas with shrubs and trees surrounding, and, you know, beds, and that
just,
would suffice.
I just think, you know, we have to look really carefully at
what,
the performance standards.
To eliminate forested areas? So,
yeah.
Is that what you're trying to get? So you could just say on a previously developed lot.
Oh, previous developed lot, there's no problem.
Well, then we're not talking about any other undeveloped lots like Abajona, like, it's not Abajona, it's, Arcadia.
So what if we
that's not previously developed, so this
right.
doesn't apply to it.
Can we
this would apply to it.
Not if you said exclude it, oh, this only applies to previously developed lots.
Well,
it doesn't
oh no.
It doesn't apply to previous developed lots.
Right.
You've
right.
got
but
that inner riparian zone that is it has the performance standards for a natural habitat. That's what I thought.
I don't think what we're trying to do is address all those outlying crazy things that might come up. I think what we're trying to do is just get for, you know, almost every meeting we've got somebody, a resident here wants to cut down the tree.
Here's an
That's
example.
What we're trying
I actually had an example. I permitted an inline amplification station out in the western part of the state. And I was, I think, in the outer riparian zone, and DEP came down and said, "Boy, you're cutting down stuff, what are you gonna do to, you know?" And so
mitigate.
So I put a row of white pine around the amplification station, but it was clearly, the river was down here, and this was definitely upland. So, yeah, there is a requirement in the state to address that kind of thing.
What if we did this? I mean, I think some of what you guys are raising comes from the fact that we really talked about this mostly as a homeowner policy. So what if we say this applies to homeowners, and if you're a developer of any kind, this isn't really this
meant
really doesn't
for
apply.
You.
This is if you're a homeowner wants to.
Why don't we label it homeowner tree cutting policy?
Yeah. Would that get at?
We're still going to need to think about the riverfront.
We can do that. Yeah. So we agree.
Yeah,
so Chuck's going to look at that. We'll all look at that.
It. Yeah.
But does the homeowner thing address some of the more esoteric questions that we would rather those types of applications still come.
And those applications could take in one at a time, on
well,
their own merit.
I mean, that's what we're doing today.
Well, a big development that comes in is gonna be a notice of intent.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's gonna get covered anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So do you wanna change this to homeowner tree cutting policy?
Or residential?
Yeah.
Residential can be Johnson Woods.
Yeah,
I think leaving it homeowner conveys the intent of use.
Residential, yeah.
I mean, we're not at the state house here. We're not.
No, that's what
and it is
I
just
agree.
A policy.
I agree.
We're just trying to be clear about what we think we would require and what would be necessary for them to submit, because
just
I think.
Just
and I dare some lawyer to come and say, well, this doesn't apply because he's technically. Fine. You're right. Whatever. We'll just. It won't apply to you. We'll have a regular meeting over it.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
But I think it will, once we get to the end of this, I think it will be handy for a homeowner to have some sort of flow chart and see, and we'll have a more consistent way of applying
I agree.
What we want, what we're asking for,
right.
What
I'm,
we're requiring.
I'm done talking about it. Everybody else come too?
So I move we continue this discussion to the next meeting.
Second.
All those in favor?
I want to keep talking.
Said you were tired a half hour ago.
Now I'm punchy. Oh, I'm sorry. Can I ask Chuck one question on this? I'm sorry, because I meant to ask this. How to request approval, was that part okay with you? Applicants should call the town conservation administrator for instructions on how to get their request on the agenda of the commission.
Yeah, I think that's always fine.
Okay.
I actually encourage people to call me if they don't want
to
read the regulations.
Do we have any open topics?
We don't. We just have what's on old and new business would be the only open topics I know of.
We talked about them.
Yep.
Can I bring up a topic? In lieu of Mr. Mond's history with and longstanding service to conservation, I was gonna propose that we have a send-off for him.
I think that's an awesome idea. I was gonna take him out for drinks tonight.
But he's not here. So.
Did somebody say drinks?
Yeah.
Should we close the meeting and talk about that? So, honestly, I don't
know.
Yeah,
it's not a. It's. I don't think it needs to be
discussed further.
Right.
And sanctioned. Make a motion that we.
And thank you, Julie.
Oh, you're welcome.
Thank you
very
much.
We'll miss you.
Julie can come for cocktails too. With Julie.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, absolutely.
So
Chuck's buying, so I'm excited.
I move we close the meeting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Second.
Yeah.
All those in favor? Meeting's closed. What have you guys done in the past?
Let's see. For it's been so many.
Are we off yet or not?
For we should be. For Barbara Cook, we went out to a restaurant. I think for Bill Hecht, we went out to a restaurant. So Bertucci's. It was flatbread. I knew. I don't know. I don't know. But
picnic in the woods.
Rebecca, do you want to reach out to him and
talk
to him and see?
Well, we shouldn't ask somebody. What do you want us to do for you? For your going away party.
Well,
be planning his own going away party.
I could call his house and try and have a. I could leave a note at his house and see if I can get through to have his wife recommend a place.
Well, there's.
I mean, that's.
What'd you do for Bill?
I think we did flatbread, Portland pie.
Portland pie? Was that any good?
It's okay.
It was good, but it's no longer open.
It was okay.
Portland
right?
pie, is it open anymore?
I don't think so.
It's shut down.
Yeah, it's
really?
Shut down.
I don't like the men, you know, I like the atmosphere.
I don't like the men.